Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jadrow, the Director of Portfolio Management at TRICOM. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, TRICOM was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenter today is Brad Bialy, social media and content marketing strategist with Haley Marketing Group. Brad is passionate about helping organizations develop and implement strategic digital marketing strategies to reach defined business goals. Since 2016, Brad has motivated and educated more than 3,000 staffing industry members through 50-plus industry-specific conferences and webinar series. He has helped oversee the social media and content marketing strategy and comprehensive marketing execution of over 250 staffing and recruiting firms, guiding the strategy and delivery of multiple industry award-winning social media campaigns. Brad oversees the product development of Haley Marketing's Social Pro service, an award-winning social media marketing solution designed specifically for the staffing and recruiting industry. Think for a moment about why you got into staffing, whether you fell into it by luck or made a conscious decision to pursue a career in the staffing industry. The reason you continue to stay in the staffing industry is arguably the same day after day, the candidate. While we strive to put the candidate first, observations from throughout the industry continue to show one alarming truth. The candidate experience is broken. In today's Industry Insider webinar, Brad will discuss how might we get back to our foundation and put the candidate first. By the end of this session, you will see how digital marketing, of all things, can fix your broken candidate experience. If you have questions during the presentation, please utilize the chat feature. After the presentation, we'll have some time for some questions. And with that, I will turn the floor over to Brad. Brad, are you there? Brad? Brad, are you there?
I am on the line, yes.
Okay, sorry about that. Go ahead.
Yeah, sorry. Let me try one more. I think maybe something just happened with my speakerphone. Can you hear me fine here now?
I can hear you now.
Perfect. Sorry about that. I can hear you just fine, and I just got around to saying thank you for that tremendous introduction. I really appreciate it. And I want to thank everybody for joining me on today's presentation of the foundation, 7 ways digital marketing can fix your broken candidate experience. As we get started here, just a quick bit of housekeeping. As Amanda mentioned, please use the chat window if you have questions throughout the presentation. And I would also love to connect with you on LinkedIn. After the presentation, if you want to search for Brad Bialy or shoot me a quick message, I have all of my contact information at the end of the presentation. I would love to connect, answer any questions that you might have that you don't necessarily share during the presentation. I would love to answer those after on LinkedIn. The Burj Khalifa, standing tall at nearly half a mile in the sky, it is the largest skyscraper in the world, and it is the pride of Dubai. If we think about the Burj Khalifa, it stands just over half a mile from the ground to the top of its satellite at the very peak of the Burj Khalifa. So I have one question for everybody. Anybody brave enough to stand on the top of the Burj Khalifa? I know I certainly am not. I know there might be one or two of you on today's call who think, hey, it's not that high, but for me, there is no shot I would get up there. I have another question. So we think about the Burj Khalifa, and we think about how it stands at just over half a mile in the sky, I want to think about something that's very relatable, the Bellagio. So I was just in Las Vegas last week speaking at an industry conference, and I asked this question, and there was only one individual in the room who got the answer right. So to get everybody familiar with the chat window, to make sure everybody knows where that window is, I'm going to ask that you use the next couple seconds here just to put in a response. And if we had to stack the Bellagio on top of itself, how many Bellagios would it take to reach the top of the Burj Khalifa? And I'm going to open up the chat window here as well so I can see everyone's responses. And again, just a fun little practice here to make sure everybody knows where that chat window is in case you do have questions as we move forward in the presentation. I'll just give you a quick second to navigate over to that window and answer in your guess at how many Bellagios it takes to get to the top. See a couple coming through, and just for sake of the presentation here, what it's going to take is 5.3 Bellagios to get to the top of the Burj Khalifa. So if you've ever been in Las Vegas, you think about how large the Bellagio is, it really puts into perspective how big that tall skyscraper is. Now, you're probably thinking as you're sitting here at your desk or as you're joining me through audio, what the heck does this have to do with me? What does this have to do with staffing and recruiting? And most importantly, what does this have to do with the candidate experience? You see, for a giant skyscraper to make it and continue to stand in the wind, in the elements, with all that weight and all that size, requires an incredible foundation, requires an incredible infrastructure that supports what is that skyscraper. Just like a skyscraper, we as individuals require an incredible foundation to help fulfill who we are, to help build us into the individuals that we've become. Now, as Amanda alluded to in the introduction here, I want you to think about your foundation. Think about why you got into staffing. Think about how you got into staffing. Now, as we talk through staffing and recruiting agencies across the country at Haley Marketing, what we continue to see time after time is that there's a overwhelming majority of individuals who kind of just fell into staffing. You know, no one goes to college and says, oh, I'm going to get a degree in recruiting. I'm not going to get a degree in staffing. But everybody that just so happens to fall into staffing, we found stays in this industry for one specific reason, and that's the candidate. Putting great people to jobs, putting great people to work in great opportunities day after day. It's a truly incredible industry to be a part of. It's one that I'm very proud to be a part of. And as we think about really the core focus of what we're doing every single day, putting great people to work in great opportunities, that's our foundation. Now, while we are saying all this positive feedback about the candidate experience, there is one scary truth. In a study of 100,000 individuals, 73% of candidates rate job searching as one of the most stress-inducing things in life. More stressful than public speaking, doing their taxes, or even getting a root canal. 32% of candidates in this same survey rate their most recent job search as very good. Well, you might be saying, hey, it's 32% of people said it's very good. When I look at that number, that just tells me that 68% of individuals felt that their job search fell below a threshold that they considered to be very good. You know, for me, that's alarming. We think about the fact that individuals are afraid of looking for their next job because of the stress it induces, and only 32% of individuals who have gone through the job search have considered their experience to be very good. That, to me, tells me that we have a broken candidate experience. You know, we strive to put the candidate first. We strive to create world-class service and make sure that we're putting great people in great opportunities, but the data shows that the candidate might not agree. So I'm here today on the TRICOM webinar series to walk through what I consider to be the foundation, 7 ways digital marketing can fix your broken candidate experience. We're going to go through 7 very different areas of digital marketing. If you have questions as these come up, please feel free to use the questions or chat window. If you've deployed some of these tactics and you want to share your take on those, I would love to see those as well. Please feel free to use either of those windows. I know I'll be monitoring those. Amanda will be monitoring those as well. If we can get to them during the presentation, that's great. If we wait till the end, that's great too. Let's get started. Number one, build your homeland. Everything starts with a website. If we think about digital marketing and we think about the latest trends and how everything shifts to maybe a social media focused, an email focused, a text focused ecosystem, everything that we do starts and ends with a homeland, starts and ends with a website. Without a great website, ultimately we're playing on rented land. It's a great quote that I heard from another marketer a little while ago that said, you want to build on your homeland, not on rented land. If everything that you're doing is on Facebook or LinkedIn or a job aggregator site like Indeed or ZipRecruiter, what happens to you as an organization if those platforms go away? So we want to build on a homeland and distribute to rented land. So we want to start with a website. If we think about funneling a website, what we ultimately want to do is funnel candidate traffic. We want to reduce friction, and we want to funnel those individuals to key pages where they can take action as easily and efficiently as possible. See the example on your screen here from LaborMax Staffing. Very, very clear what they do when you get to this homepage. Changing people's lives is what we do. Putting them back to work is how we do it. What I love about the website is not only do they have this very clear directly on the homepage, but as you look at the right side of the screen, ready to get to work, apply now. Very easy and efficient to get to this job board. So if I'm an applicant, not only do I understand what LaborMax does, but I also have a very clear and direct path where I can take action, where I can then apply for an opportunity. We don't just want to look at a desktop experience either. We also want to look at the mobile experience. You know, I might even argue that the mobile experience is more important than the desktop experience. We've been tracking data at Haley Marketing for our collective job board users for quite some time now. I pulled data here for, again, a presentation that I was delivering last week that I also wanted to include here, where we looked at job board traffic from mobile devices. And if you look at job board traffic from mobile devices, in February of 2020, just over 63% of all individuals, all traffic that came to a Haley Marketing Group job board came from a mobile device. So what I would challenge you to do is think through the mobile application on your website. Physically sit down and time yourself and see how long it takes you to apply to a given job on your website. Can you apply on a mobile device? Is your mobile application causing friction? At what point in the process do you yourself, someone that works for the organization, get frustrated? If you're getting frustrated, just think what is happening to the candidate who is applying to that opportunity while they're looking at a commercial at night. If they're using their mobile device as a second screen and they're watching a sports event or a game or a show and they're applying during that commercial, what's that process like? Can they even apply? Are you requiring documents like a resume or a cover letter or references, documents that they might not have on their phone, on their mobile device? So really think through not only the user experience and the candidate experience on desktop, but also think about what that translates to on mobile. And as a challenge, I would really ask that you go through your application and you think about any points of friction that might slow down the candidate, that might create some sort of friction for them to actually click apply. I wanted to include this great stat here. I referenced the call to action on the LaborMax website. It's a client out of Lehigh Valley that we've worked with for quite some time, and we've been tracking the apply now button at the bottom of their website in a mobile or a desktop fly-in rather for quite some time. And what we've noticed is that 65, just under 66% of traffic direct to this job opportunity came from this button specifically. So while they have this job listed on other job aggregators, they have the job on their job board, they feed it out through social media, they distribute it in email blasts and text blasts. As we look at the data and we look at how users are getting to this job, how candidates are getting to a very specific job for them, the majority of them are getting there because of one very clear and direct button on the homepage. So the challenge for you in thinking through your candidate experience is what job order are you actively trying to fill right now? What is your number one opportunity that you need applications for? And how can you edit your website design to funnel that traffic as easily and efficiently as possible to get that candidate from point A to point B as quickly and easily as possible. Number two, we need to improve the conversation, and we need to listen first and talk second. Now, I used to play guitar in the Buffalo area quite a bit, and there was a show that I was on with a touring musician. We were sitting at the bar having a drink before our set, and he got to knowing what I did for a living, really, which was digital marketing and social media marketing. And he's kind of picking my brain on a couple different ideas and topics here. And you know, he had said, Brad, every day I get messages and comments from fans, really, on Twitter. Should I be responding to those? And I looked at him and I said, Carter, if you were sitting here talking to me and all that I was doing was sitting on my phone or looking the other way or talking to somebody else, would you keep talking to me or would you get up and walk away? And I swear I saw the lights turn on and I saw his mentality shift. Candidates that are coming to you with questions, if you're not actively responding to them, I'm here to tell you that they're getting that answer from somebody else, and it's probably your direct competitor. We need to improve the conversation in the candidate experience, and we need to listen first and talk second. We don't just want to shout into the noise that might be social media or digital marketing. We don't just want to shout into the clutter. We want to listen to what candidates are saying, and then we want to respond to them. We want to join that conversation. I love this slide. Probably one of my favorite slides in this entire presentation deck. Facebook Messenger, the graveyard of leads. These are examples from clients that we're working with at Haley Marketing, real examples of the Facebook dashboard as I logged in just a couple weeks ago. To me, there are roughly 100 leads on this page that are not being followed up with. I would challenge you to look at your Facebook page as your organization and think through how many inbox messages you have right now from candidates who are reaching out asking questions about job opportunities, who are reaching out asking about services, asking how you can help, how you can provide better service, a better opportunity for them, and actively respond to those messages. You know, this might not be the ideal candidate for job A, but maybe you can work with them to get them into the right role. Maybe you can help find them their next opportunity. As we look at record low unemployment, we need to understand that looking at candidates as individuals and coaching them through to that next step is a great way to convert them into the next opportunity. So we want to use Facebook Messenger as a lead opportunity. Make sure we're having that conversation, making sure we're listening first and then talking second. We want to make it easy to apply, and we want to sell the job. Number three, if we think through making it easy to apply, this is on both desktop and a mobile device. And I know I alluded to this in a couple slides prior about making sure that mobile application is easy, making sure it's efficient. But ultimately, we want to sell the job. We want to think through how we can have a mobile application that is user-friendly. We want to include salary. We want a captivating description. We want to sell the job like a beer commercial, and I'll explain that in a second. And most importantly, we want to follow up. So let's walk through these 5 points real quickly here. Thinking through the mobile application, and I know I already mentioned I alluded to this a couple slides prior, but we want the mobile application to be accessible to any and all applicants when they're ready for it. So we think about the mobile application, we're thinking through how can we have a candidate apply to a job when they're ready on their time, regardless of the situation that they're in. So if someone is looking at one of your jobs on your website on a mobile device, can they apply? Can they physically get to the end of the application process? Can they click submit application, or are you requiring information in documents that might not be accessible on mobile? How could we pivot that mobile device to be more user-friendly for the candidate? We want to include salary. We look at data throughout the industry, and what we've seen consistently is that job listings that include salary oftentimes get more application than jobs that do not. And there's really a fundamental reason why. If you think about record low unemployment, and we think about sitting right now around that just under 4% unemployment. I know for some specific states and cities, it's even lower than that. I was speaking in Colorado last year, and somebody raised their hand when I started talking about this. They said, Brad, around here, it's about 2% unemployment. I mean, physically, everybody that can have a job has a job right now for the most part. If we think about why and how we can get a passive candidate to go from job A to job B, salary is oftentimes a leading indicator there. If we think through the candidate themselves, maybe it's a better experience in their next job. But including salary might get you and might motivate an individual to go from job A to job B. Maybe an extra dollar an hour really goes a long way for them. Maybe it's more than that. We want to include salary, the data supports it, and also just thinking through the user experience and thinking through passive candidates also supports that claim. A captivating description that sells the job like a beer commercial, not a job advertisement. At Haley Marketing, we host a weekly podcast called The Secrets of Staffing Success. And in our first episode with Jennifer Lambert, she was talking to our host, Todd Lewandowski, and she said that we have to sell the job like a beer commercial. You know, most staffing and recruiting firms are selling a job description like beer ingredients. You're pre-qualifying the candidate based on a series of parameters, but you're not selling the job itself. And if we think through how we can pivot that, it's selling the job like a beer commercial. You know, why should you be in this role? Why do you want to leave your job for this opportunity? What makes this job so appealing? You know, it's not pre-qualifying. It's not thinking through, oh, do you have 3 to 5 years experience? Are you able to lift XYZ? Can you carry 50 pounds from point A to point B? I'm thinking through a warehouse opportunity, for example. But instead, it's selling it like that ad. It's being descriptive, and it's using captivating copy that captivates the audience's attention. Now, if we think about marketing 101, and we use that ADA model, and we think about attention, interest, desire, and action, and we funnel somebody through that four-step process, if you're going through the action process before you captivate their attention, there's really no way to have that conversion take place. So we want to first gain their attention. We want to get their interest. We want to spark their desire to actually take that action. So we want to sell the job like an advertisement, not a commercial, not an ad. I'm sorry, like the ingredients rather. And then ultimately, we want to follow up. You know, I have a hard time thinking through the candidate experience as we talk to different staffing and recruiting firms. But we talked about how applicants find the application process and searching for their next job more fear-inducing than doing their taxes. But we think through the fact of why. It really comes down to the majority of the candidates aren't being followed up with. And if you think through what that does to an individual, it leads them to a feeling of, you know, really questioning their self-worth, questioning their value, questioning whether or not they're qualified. You know, why didn't I get the job? Why didn't I even hear back? You know, what's wrong with me that they couldn't even pick up the phone or shoot me an email and say, hey, Brad, you're really qualified in XYZ, but we're looking for A, B, and C, and it's just not the right fit. You know, we'll keep your resume on file, though. You know, we need to, as an industry, follow up with individuals to make sure that we're not just sending candidates into a black hole after they click apply. When somebody clicks apply, what does your process automation look like? Do you have a series of automation that follows up with the individual? Or is your team actively following up? You know, I would really challenge you to think through that process. And as you're going through the application on your website, really be mindful of what automation you're receiving, what email prompts you're receiving. Do you get a notification saying that your application was received? What happens 3 days later, 5 days later? We really want to be mindful of that. We really want to make sure that we're not sending the applicant into a black hole of just, hey, apply, and then they don't hear back. We really want to be sure that we're following up strategically and letting them know what's happening through the process. I wanted to look briefly at specific data, and I used our job board as a reference point, but really this relates to any sort of ATS or job board that you might be using. And really the point of this slide here is thinking through the candidate experience in terms of how you're measuring the success of the jobs that you're posting. So do you have a quantifiable dashboard that shows you the number of jobs that you're actively hiring for? Do you know how many individuals are looking at those jobs? Do you know how many applications you're receiving? You know, do you know the cost per application? Thinking through these numbers and these key metrics helps you understand the candidate experience a little bit more. If you have 100 jobs on your website and you're only receiving one or two applications, it's very clear to understand that there is some sort of friction from somebody looking at the job to actually applying. Thinking through the number of applies per job, if you know it takes you 30 applications to find the right individual, well, then you know that you need to step up your game and either invest in job advertising or social media marketing or some sort of way to get individuals back to those jobs. So really the purpose here, I know I grabbed data from our specific job board. The point here is to be mindful of your specific metrics and understand that you can set up a dashboard for yourself to understand the candidate experience and understand how your job board is converting individuals into applicants. Number four, stay top of mind and create systematic touch points. As we look at marketing and marketing technology in 2020, one of the best ways to improve the candidate experience is to create systematic touch points. Use artificial intelligence, use some sort of marketing tech to really create touch points that allow you to stay top of mind. You know, the first is Facebook advertising. If we think about staying in front of candidates, what we want to think about doing is deploy what we consider to be remarketing, or we at Haley Marketing Group call it re-recruiting. What we learned in looking at data is a repeat visitor to a job is twice as likely to apply for that individual opportunity. So if you think through remarketing, and if you're not familiar with it, I'm certain you've seen it in action. If you think about the last time you were on a site like Amazon, chances are very high that as you left Amazon and went to Facebook, you were followed by the product you just looked at. That product follows you, it drives you back to Amazon to actually buy the product, and then you stop seeing the ad. You know, we could do that with job opportunities. So if an individual comes to your website, they don't apply for a job, they leave. Now as they go to Facebook, they're seeing ads for your organization where that individual can come back and apply now, or they can simply like your page or learn more about your opportunities. And we have three very distinct call to actions here as examples on purpose, but it's thinking through the candidate experience. If an individual is coming to your website and they're not ready to apply, how can you stay in front of them? How can you systematically stay top of mind to get them to come back to your site to apply when they're ready? You know, if somebody comes to your website and they leave, are you making a memorable first impression? Are you staying on their mind, or are they thinking, huh, who did I just look at the other day? You know, who was that staff informer? Where was that job listed? It's a great way to stay top of mind, continue to stay in front of those individuals, and ultimately drive traffic back to your job opportunities where individuals can apply and take action. Improving your identity and owning your reputation. If we think about staffing and recruiting, we as an industry have a very challenging reputation to improve. And there's one reason why. If you think about a given job opportunity that you have on your website, let's say you're hiring one individual for a very specific role, and you receive 100 applications for that role, you have now consequently made 99 people upset because they didn't get the job and one person did. So what do those 99 people do? They go to Facebook, they go to Google, they go to Indeed, and they leave a bad review. Don't work with XYZ Staffing, they're not gonna find you an opportunity. Don't go to ABC Staffing, they never followed up with me or I didn't get the opportunity and I don't even know why. You get this negative feedback, right? And when we think about it, when we think about online reviews, perception is reality. We wanna look at what story do your reviews tell? And this isn't just staffing. You know, think about a local pizza place, think about a local bar or restaurant. If you're looking for food, and you're looking at, well, where should we go this week or this evening? And you Google bars near me or pizza near me. What comes up? It's always those businesses that have high ratings. So Google is in business to show the best answer to a search query. Staffing is the exact same. If you are flooded with negative reviews, not only is Google not going to show your organization there because they want to show individual organizations that are creating a positive experience, but if you do have a low rating and your competitor has a high rating, individuals are going to go right there anyways. They're going to go somewhere else. So we want to think through the story that your reviews tell. And we want to try to generate positive online reviews. And how can you do that? Well, put simply, you can ask individuals that you know are having a great experience. We talked about a statistic on the Secrets of Staffing Success, specifically on the Insights show as a part of the Secrets of Staffing Success, where we said there was a stat that said 88% of individuals are likely to leave online feedback if prompted to do so. The challenge there is organizations don't ask for that feedback. If 8 out of 10, almost 9 out of 10 individuals will leave feedback if prompted to do so, we need to ask those individuals that are having a great experience on their assignment to leave us that feedback. I also want to talk about mitigating risk and what should you do if you do receive negative feedback. There's a great book by Jay Baer called Hug Your Haters, which walks through a two-step process of what to do if you receive negative feedback. And I'm going to walk through that real quick because I do think it is a great piece of information. So let's say you log into Google one day and you see a negative review. Somebody reaches out and says, don't work with XYZ staffing. They stink. They will never find you work. They never call you back. Insert any other sort of rant here. What you're going to do is you're going to respond once. You're going to say, Brad, really sorry you had a negative experience. We strive to provide world-class service, and it seems like we fell short. I would love to chat. You can shoot me an email, include your email address, or give me a call and include the line to your office. Let's say they come back a second time. I don't want to talk to you. Like I said, you're not even going to return my call. You didn't in the past. You didn't find me a job opportunity. Oh, and the jobs listed on your website stink. We're going to reply a second time. Brad, we understand that you had a negative experience. We would love to chat with you about this. Please give us a call at the office, or you can shoot me an email directly, include your email address. If they respond a third time, at that point, we're going to let it go. We have done everything that we can to preserve the brand, preserve the reputation of the organization. The last thing that we want to do is get into a shouting match with somebody that's frustrated online. You know, Warren Buffett said it takes 20 years to build your reputation and 5 minutes to ruin it. We don't want to ruin what you've worked so hard to build. So we're going to respond twice, and we're always going to try to get that remaining feedback offline. Like I said, we don't want to get into a shouting match with a candidate. We want to have them feel like they're being heard privately. Always ask for a phone call or ask for an email to get their follow-up offline, to get it off of a public forum. We want to dominate search results. So I started to allude to search engine optimization and showing up in Google search results, but really we want to actively work at this. If we think about improving the candidate experience, we want to make sure that it's easy to find your organization when somebody is searching for it. Yes, we want to make sure that we have branded keywords and authority in the organization that you work for, Brad's staffing agency. If searched for, that should show up in Google. It's a branded keyword search. But we also want to begin to rank for things like Buffalo staffing agencies, jobs in Buffalo, working in Buffalo, employment in Buffalo, employment agencies in Buffalo. As we dominate search results and as we start to beat the competition there, then we start to funnel traffic back to our website, where our website, as I mentioned in point number one, can funnel the individual to take action. So we drive everybody back to our homeland where then they can take action. They can apply for a job. They can reach out if they have questions. They can call us. They could learn about who we are as an organization. They can see other testimonials. But we want to dominate search results. We want to do so by deploying search engine optimization strategies and tactics that will help us stand out from the competition and rank well on Google. If we want to think about continuing to improve the candidate experience, we want to educate the candidate. Content, content, content. Something that I say all the time at Haley Marketing, and it's something that I'm consistently pushing in presentations that I deliver. But we want to educate the candidate. Amid record low unemployment, right now we're looking at individuals who might be ready for the next step in their career. We want to educate them into how to get there, why they should trust you with making that next step, why they should trust you over another organization. So how do we educate the candidate? Well, it starts by making sure every post has a purpose, making sure everything that you're creating, whether it's a blog article or a social media post or a job post, a job listing, every post has to have a purpose. You know, if you're sitting down at your computer and you're thinking, oh, I got to post something on Facebook today, really think through the why. You know, what message are you trying to share? What action are you trying to get somebody to actually take? And is your post captivating enough for somebody to scroll, that's scrolling through social, to actually stop and take action? So every post has to have a purpose. We want to make sure that not only does the post have a purpose, we want to make sure that it ultimately funnels individuals to take action. Every post, regardless of if it's on a job board, if it's on your blog, if it's in a resource center, or a social media post, should have a call to action. What should I, the applicant, or the candidate do after reading this? Is it just something to make me feel good, you know, some Monday motivation, a fun fact Friday type of post? Maybe it's just a funny gif of something from around your office or your team at a team building event. Am I just supposed to feel good? Or am I supposed to take action? If we think through educating the candidate, this is a great example here on your screen here, what to expect on your first assignment with LaborMax. So it goes through a series of steps about what you as an individual should expect on your first assignment. But what if I'm not already working with LaborMax? That's where the call to action on the side of the screen funnel the individual to take action. And I specifically love the organization that our team built when laying out these calls to action. First, search jobs now. If you're on the client side and you're seeing this, you can request an employee. And third, contact us. We want individuals to be able to take action on their own because we don't necessarily know when they'll be looking at our website. If somebody comes to your website and the only call to action is to call us or email us or chat with us through a chat window or a chat bot, we need to think through who is going to be monitoring that on the other side of that line. If the call to action is call us and it's 12:30 at night, what is that end user, that candidate, going to see? What are they going to hear? What is their experience going to be? So here's why I love funneling people to browse available jobs where they can apply online on their time, whether it's 3 in the morning, 3 in the afternoon, 9 p.m. An individual can apply to this job regardless of the time. Request an employee can happen anywhere, whenever. Get in touch with us. This is a contact form that will go and get routed to a team. But there's going to be a prompt after that that says we'll get back to you in 24 hours. It's setting a clear expectation for the candidate. Love the funnel of this. So really think through, if I could challenge you to look at your website, think through what your blog looks like. Is your blog speaking with purpose? Does every post have a purpose? Does it have a very clear call to action? Are you funneling candidates to apply? Or are you just kind of creating content that is more or less cluttering the noise? Make sure every post has a purpose and make sure that we're educating the candidate. Last and arguably the most important point here in the presentation as we look at the foundation is getting back to our foundation. The most human company wins. We think about the staffing and recruiting industry. We're in business, we exist to put great people in great opportunities. At our foundation, we're an organization of individuals, we're an industry rather, not an organization, of individuals helping individuals. We need to get back to our foundation and ultimately be human. There's a great quote on your screen here from Mark Schaefer. He's the author of Marketing Rebellion. It says, be more human. No matter what happens next, if we use that as our constant guide and filter, we'll be okay. The most human company wins. Now, as we look at this presentation of the foundation, 7 ways digital marketing can fix your broken candidate experience. As we look at digital marketing, ultimately, we want to get back to our foundation. We want to be more human, and we want to make sure that we're putting the candidate first. We want to make sure that the candidate experience remains our foundation, that everything we're doing exists to make sure that the candidate experience is positive. Because ultimately, if it's not, those candidates are going to go to your local competition. They're going to go somewhere else where the experience is better for them. So again, Mark Schaefer said, be more human. No matter what happens next, if we use that as our constant guide and filter, we'll be okay. The most human company wins. If you're taking notes throughout the presentation, I appreciate that. I will also make sure that Amanda gets this slide deck. But if you were missing notes, and just in case you missed anything, I'm going to walk through the 7 ways digital marketing can fix your broken experience, your broken candidate experience once more. First, build your homeland. Always start with a website. Everything that you do should funnel back to that homeland. Everything that you do should funnel candidates back to your homeland. 2, improve the conversation. We want to listen first and we want to talk second. We want to think through the fact that if candidates are asking questions, they're going to get the answer to that question somewhere. We want it to be from you. 3, make it easy to apply. Sell the job. Don't just list the ingredients of the beer. Sell it like a beer advertisement. We think about your jobs online. Don't just use a job listing as a pre-qual. Don't just use it as a way to pre-qualify candidates. Use it as a way to captivate their attention, to excite them, to get them to want to apply for this job opportunity. 4, stay top of mind by creating systematic touch points. How can you use digital marketing to stay in front of candidates and applicants that may have looked at your website but didn't take action to apply? Create those touch points to ultimately stay top of mind and funnel those individuals back to your website. 5, improve your identity by owning your reputation. Think through actively building your online reputation on sites like Google, Facebook. Think through what individuals are saying about you. Perception is reality when it comes to online reviews, and we want to make sure that you're putting your best foot forward when you are being searched for online. 6, educate the candidate. Content, content, content. If you're looking at educating passive candidates, how can you get them from point A to point B? How can you earn their trust so that when an individual is looking for their next job opportunity, they know to come to you instead of a local competitor? And ultimately, 7, get back to the foundation. The most human company wins. As we look at the candidate experience in 2020, the best digital marketing experience won't save the fact of your organization having to be human. The best digital marketing is just a supplement to your personal touch. You think through the industry that we're in of putting great people to work in great opportunities. We need to make sure that we're human. We need to make sure that we're actively communicating with candidates, that we're actively reaching out, that we're putting the candidate experience above everything else. I do want to share real briefly that we do host a great podcast at Haley Marketing. Every other week, Todd Lewandowski from our team interviews innovators and thought leaders from throughout the industry to get their insights into what made their staffing firm successful. On the off weeks of that interview series, myself and Matt Lozar, our director of recruitment marketing, host a show called Insights, where we talk about content marketing, social recruiting, and employer branding throughout staffing and recruiting, talking about ways that your staffing firm and your recruiting firm to really leverage those different tactics on a day-to-day basis. You can subscribe to The Secrets of Staffing Success on your preferred podcast player. It's also accessible at haleymarketing.com. If you have any questions, at this time, Amanda, I'd love to open it up to Q&A. And my contact information is also on the window here if you'd like to follow up afterwards. You can shoot me an email, or you can connect with me at Brad Biley on LinkedIn. I would love to continue the conversation and chat with you if you have any questions regarding today's presentation or your own digital marketing strategy.
Thank you so much, Brad. We've covered a lot of material in a short time here. We have now opened the floor for questions. So for anyone that has questions about any type of marketing experience or troubles that you guys might be having, Brad is a great person to kind of field some of those questions for you. You can do so now using the chat feature or certainly offline as well by connecting with him directly. As we're taking a look and just waiting for some questions to come in, would you mind just sharing quickly, kind of a quick overview here of what you think the best takeaway, an actionable item that our viewers today can take away and implement within their organization immediately?
Yeah, it's a phenomenal question. If you had to get started this afternoon, I would really start with auditing your website and auditing your candidate experience. So ghost shop yourself. I know they have malls will typically have secret shoppers where they go in and they shop around different clothing stores and they get a feel for what the organization is like. Secret shop your own organization. You know, when you're at home this evening, physically try to apply to a job opportunity on your website, on your mobile device. Think through where there's friction and where you personally get frustrated. Go through your website, look at content. Is it funneling like it should? You know, is your website doing what it's supposed to? What sort of identity do you have on social media or on a site like Google? You know, as we looked at the seven ways that digital marketing can fix a broken candidate experience, really, you need to understand what your organization is doing first before you can improve. So if you were to get started this afternoon or over the weekend, I would really recommend and I would challenge anybody on today's call or even watching the replay, really challenge you to audit yourself and go through and try to apply to a job or pretend you're a candidate. Go through the process and see what it's like.
Great point. I think that is a really great suggestion for anyone to before they determine what their actionable steps would be to kind of experience it and then from there decide, you know, what piece do you want to tackle first and, you know, start small, start with something and then move forward from there.
Yeah, that's another great point too, Amanda, is the presentation. I know there's a lot thrown into, you know, a 45-50 minute presentation here. The goal with any sort of digital marketing talk isn't to overwhelm or inundate you with so much information that you don't get started. You know, think about this as your digital marketing workout program. You know, you wouldn't get started if you've never ran a marathon. You wouldn't wake up tomorrow with a new pair of shoes and just try to run those 26 miles. You instead would maybe go for a walk. You'd go around the block. Maybe you'd run halfway. You'd ease into that. You know, digital marketing and social media marketing is the exact same. We're not challenging anybody to jump all in. You know, you don't have to do all of this, but start with maybe just one takeaway from today's presentation. Start there. You know, audit your job listing. Take notes. Go through that and then do something else. Build on that. Just like a workout program, ease into that marathon. Don't just go out and try to do it all this weekend.
A question that has come in related to social media posting. Can you tell me, you know, is there a good rule of thumb as to how many people in your organization have access or ability to be able to present the company out on those social media sites? Or do you have someone that's really managing that process?
Done. Incredible question, and thank you for sharing that. your team is instinctively an internal army of brand advocates. And I have a great talk on personal branding that I think, actually, Amanda, I may have shared last year for Tricom, but that really is how to amplify your personal brand. If we're looking at who should have access to an organizational Facebook page, for example, you know, who in your office should have the Twitter password? You know, who should have that login on their phone? For me, it really comes down to who do you trust with that responsibility? You know, who is responsible for having that accountability? For us at, you know, Haley Marketing, we have probably 7 to 10 people that have access to our Facebook page on a team of, you know, 50 plus. And it's not that we don't trust everybody else, but it's that those 7 to 10, if they're posting throughout the day, that's who we've decided should have access to it. You know, I would think through your organization specifically and say, okay, who first off needs access? So if you're posting jobs, maybe all of your recruiters need access because they need to be able to go in and message individuals. But then who else should have access to that? Who is posting for, you know, your team builders? Who is going through those motions? Who's posting for, you know, different events that occur? I don't have, and I'm trying to get to a clear answer here, but really I think it comes down to your personal trust level. You know, who do you trust with having access to these pages at any hour of the day? And then really understanding their why. So why does an individual need access to the page in the first place?
Good point. And I think that's definitely something to consider, but also, you know, on the other hand, you know, to be able to respond timely and to put out more content, there may be a point where you may need to recruit assistance from other members within the company to keep that presence out there. So,
Absolutely.
Very good. Okay. Well, if anyone has any additional questions, please reach out to Brad directly. We have his contact information up on the screen. And with that, we will go ahead and close out the session. Thank you all for joining us. And look for information on our next webinar session. We will have a posting of this webinar out on our website for anyone who may want to share it or view it again at a later date. So please do visit the Tricom website for the recording. And again, thank you for your time. Brad, thank you so much for covering digital marketing for our staffing clients.
Thanks so much for having me.
Have a great day, everyone.